Hey, ChatGPT, please write a short prayer for my family. One line only.
Lord, keep my family safe, united, and filled with your love.
Amen. Religion and digital technology, at first glance, the two don't go together at all. But many believers and developers would beg to differ. Let's take a look at what technologies are out there and if they're any good. Religious guidance from AI is an idea that many have already experimented with. This US congregation even had ChatGPT write an entire church service for them.
And remember that even in a world of AI, the eternal truth of God's love shines bright.
But is this just a gimmick or is it the future? Truth is, for many, smartphones can be a great help in times of need, offering personal guidance. Religious scholar Inken Pohl from Heidelberg University takes the intersection of faith, spirituality and technology very seriously.
We have this huge field of spiritualities and mindfulness and the strive for immortality and self-optimization, which I would also call religious. And in this field, AI is playing a huge role.
For people of faith, there are many apps claiming to make everyday religious life easier. They can remind you of prayer times, send you inspiring verses from the Quran, or help you study the Torah or Bible on the go. The combined data of religious texts can be called up in an instant, for example, with this AI rabbi. The program works similarly to ChatGPT. You can ask the virtual rabbi anything and it's always available. But of course, mistakes can happen. The opportunities for AI in religious practice are endless. Try holding virtual church services, for example, or speaking directly with religious figures. How about Jesus himself? This AI Jesus, developed at Lucerne's University of Applied Sciences, was put to the test in Peter's Chapel in the same city. It's like ChatGPT, but trained on the Bible. In a test run, volunteers sat in a confessional with a bearded bot and asked him questions. The feedback was largely positive.
He reaffirmed me in my ways of going about things, and he helped me with questions I had.
I thought it was a gimmick for sure. In just 2 months, AI Jesus held around 900 conversations. Many users reported having positive experiences, but not all of them did. Some found his answers evasive. But unlike historical Jesus, at least this one can sit across from you and respond to questions. He even took on pastoral care. Too good to be true?
What AI is also doing is creating immersive experiences that we associate with feelings of transcendence in religions. And here the huge question is this authentic?
Well, many religious scholars aren't quite convinced.
It distracts us from the development of AI turning into a religion. And it makes religion important, and religious people are always interested in making themselves more important.
Interesting take. After all, for some, religion is just another means to maintain power and easily exploited for a quick buck. In 2024, so-called spiritual wellness apps generated over 2 billion euros. In the US, 1 in 3 adults use them, be it to pray, read religious texts, or meditate. Many post about religious issues on social media, too. And in doing so, they share some very personal information.
Grief, financial problems, or an impending divorce. It's this information that US churches are scouring social media profiles for, and they're using AI and big data to do it. Because in the wake of crisis, many are likely to turn to faith. For modern church missionaries, apps sold by commercial providers can compile precise information on neighborhood communities. Who lives next door to whom? And since when? How many children do they have? What's their background? Essentially, the programs analyze the data people readily provide online to find out who is vulnerable. These individuals are then targeted by churches. They're offered help, or invited to a service. Mixing data mining, up until now the domain of marketing or political campaigns, with religion is controversial.
Of course, religious institutions always work with strategies to invoke emotions. But now these strategies are multiplied and optimized by big data applications.
After all, the data concerned is very intimate, and the community applications are specifically designed to identify and target people in the middle of a crisis.
It's almost like a 21st century missionary toolkit, complete with AI, apps, and data. In the Vatican, the Pope tends to the Catholic congregation in a different way. On the online network Click to Pray, Pope Francis invites people to pray together.
Here I will include prayer intentions and requests for the mission of the Church.
Here, believers from all over the world can share their thoughts. And if that's not enough now, you can even head straight to the Vatican in virtual reality.
Yep, that's right. You can visit the Dome of St. Peter's Basilica easier than ever, thanks to a new detailed 3D model. Over weeks, drones scanned and photographed the basilica, snapping more than 400,000 photos, which were then knit together by an algorithm to create a so-called digital twin. Now, the dome can be seen from anywhere in the world. And it's just one of the many sacred sites that viewers can now explore online. Why not visit the Golden Buddha in Bangkok or the Sheikh Zayed Mosque in Abu Dhabi from the comfort of your home? A pilgrimage to the Masjid al-Haram, the sacred mosque of Mecca, is a pillar of the Muslim faith. But not everyone can afford the trip.
The Hajj is available in VR. As a matter of fact, almost all religions nowadays use digital technologies in one way or another. When I visited a Buddhist temple in Japan, I was met by a robot priest.
The name is Minder, an android made of aluminum and silicone. A robot in the image of Canon, the Buddhist deity of compassion. But this robot is much more than just tech. It's a priest, holding multimedia sermons in a Zen Buddhist temple in Kyoto. Minder was developed in collaboration with Osaka University. Looking part human, part machine, it's pretty revolutionary, don't you think? Some people find it really strange when they first come in. But after watching a 20-minute ceremony, most of them do leave thinking of Minder as a kind of Buddhist teacher. Minder's teachings have been a weekend staple since 2019, offering many different teachings.
For believers and the curious alike, which is promising. The hope is that Minder might revive some of Buddhism's spiritual appeal for today's tech-savvy generations. It was all a little strange for me, but really fascinating. In India, Hindu ceremonies are also undergoing a system update, a massive one.
Weighing in at 800 kilos, over 3 meters tall, and stunningly lifelike, this robot elephant is decked out in colorful attire for Hindu ceremonies. The animal welfare organization PETA India is trying a new approach to end cruelty against animals. The robot elephants cost around 6,000 euros. Repeated incidents with stressed animals at ceremonies prompted the innovation.
We see on a daily basis, we see all the different kinds of cruelty that is happening. And elephants running amok in, I think, almost all the temple festivals, because they happen in the heights of summer. And I don't think it's ever occurred to people that there is an alternative and you can do something like this. I think it's a really revolutionary step that they're taking, and we hope to see him in a lot of places.
Robot elephants operate in more than 10 temples in southern India, helping to keep a centuries-old tradition alive.
This is an age of electronics and technology. So why can't we improve the system? And this robotic elephant can be improved a lot bit more, and we can have the same feeling of the original elephants.
That approach makes a lot of sense to me. After all, religious rituals are all about the staging. So why not use a robot? It can be just as impressive as the live version. But showy parades aside, What would religion be without human contact? That's why more and more people of faith are using social media to spread their message.
She is known as the TikTok nun. Josefina Cattaneo has more than 200,000 followers there and over 100,000 on Instagram. Cattaneo has been active on her platform since 2020.
I guess my role is to win over young people for Jesus. That's the primary thing. And to show people that nuns are just like everyone else, normal, cheerful, and happy.
The now 30-year-old is a member of a Catholic congregation in Argentina. But when she began her social media journey, she was far from equipped for what lay ahead.
When I first downloaded the app, I didn't know how to use it. I felt so old, I wanted to die. Then I told myself, this can't be. I'm 24 years old. What does a monastery do to you? So then I started looking for tutorials on YouTube and slowly wrapped my head around how to use these kinds of programs. Then I recorded my first TikTok reel. It was a little dance that went like... That was my first one.
Since then, her videos have come a long way. She picks up on current trends, does ping-pong interviews with her sisters, or just sings and dances. There are plenty of skeptics who don't like the way she presents herself, but that won't stop her, she says.
How can making a video or using social media to share the gospel be ridiculous? Announcing the gospel and seeking strategies, looking for the what, how, or where is never ridiculous.
I think we all know the feeling of searching for answers in a confusing reality. That's why many faith influencers will try to offer simple, direct solutions. That keeps them popular on social channels like TikTok and Insta, even if there are fewer and fewer practicing believers overall. But beware, this can also be a gateway to manipulation and radicalization. One thing is for sure, religions can no longer do without digital technology. And what are your experiences? Is it an improvement or just a gimmick after all? That's it for me. See you next time.